It's been compared to the Manhattan Project and to the moon landing.
Dadgummit. Jack Schmidt having a few problems.
Today we celebrate the revelation of the first draft of the human book of life.
Without a doubt, this is the most important, most wondrous map ever produced by humankind.
What more powerful form of study of mankind could there be than to read our own instruction book?
But now that we have this map of the human genome, where exactly do we go? Tonight, mapping the genome, what does that mean? So what exactly happened today? It's not like 2,000 scientists got up this morning, flipped on their computers, tapped in some data, and then all over the world and all together they said, oh my gosh, we've just completed the list of the basic chemicals that make up a human being. Let's have a press conference. That is not what happened today. First of all, the job, in fact, is not finished. It's going to take another 2 to 3 years to complete and to check. Second, there was nothing spontaneous about today's White House announcement. Everything that happened, who spoke when, who sat where, who said what, about whom, all of that was painstakingly prearranged because the scientists involved, and we have two of the biggest ones coming up in just a moment, they are a competitive and occasionally prickly bunch who know all too well that this is going to bring some of them great glory, and of course, they want credit. Because bottom line, what was announced today is truly glorious. It's as though, says science writer Matt Ridley, that we humans were standing together in the dark inside a magnificent Gothic cathedral filled with gargoyles and pillars and interlacing stone and latticework, work which we could not see, not in the dark. But then somebody switched on the lights, and there was the whole complex, beautiful structure of a human, God's secrets gradually becoming visible. That's what started today. And to show you how, let's step back a bit.
Well, this is a very exciting milestone in history.
For years now, we've been hearing this over and over.
The complete repertoire of human genes.
A gigantic achievement, the most expensive, most ambitious biology mission ever, the biggest science project since, that you hear this all the time, since the moon landing. Of course, most of us understood the moon landing. Either they landed or they didn't.
That's a good step.
That we all got. This, however, is a little harder. What is a human genome, anyway? Well, to begin, you probably do know that in each of your cells there's a strand of chemicals, DNA, that contain, on the steps of this ladder here, a complete set of instructions to make a human being. So, if you can figure out the chemicals that make up this step, and then this step, and this step, and on for 3 billion steps, you would have the code for a human. The problem is that DNA is so incredibly small. How do you see these tiny chemicals? Well, all over the world for the past few years, scientists, sponsored by the U.S. government's Human Genome Project and by private firms, have been using computers. And here's what they do. You start with a little bit of human DNA, which you then put into the computer, and then it literally isolates each rung of the ladder. It sees each chemical.
And you can see here that there are 4 A's with green peaks.
The chemicals have letter names, so here you've got a G, C, 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 A, G, A. Each rung is being decoded in the right order, and after a few weeks you see thousands and thousands and thousands of rungs, and after several years doing this, we now have more than 90%, an almost complete list in the right sequence of the chemical instructions that create a human being. So what have we learned? Well, think about what it takes to fix a car, says research scientist Eric Lander.
When you take your car into an auto mechanic, they know all the parts of your car, and that's essential for fixing any problem. That's the same thing the Genome Project is doing for medicine now. For the first time, doctors have access to all the parts.
Which means one day, sorry, should Eric get sick, knowing his very specific genetic makeup, doctors would be able to give him medicines perfectly suited.
Simon & Schuster Audio presents Einstein, His Life and Universe by Walter Isaacson. Read by Edward Herman.
The Light Beam Rider. I promise you four papers, the young patent examiner wrote his friend. The letter would turn out to bear some of the most significant tidings in the history of science, but its momentous nature was masked by an impish tone that was typical of its author. He had, after all, just addressed his friend as, "You frozen whale," and apologized for writing a letter that was inconsequential babble. Only when he got around to describing the papers, which he had produced during his spare time, did he give some indication that he sensed their significance. The first deals with radiation and the energy properties of light, and is very revolutionary, he explained. Yes, it was indeed revolutionary. It argued that light could be regarded not just as a wave, but also as a stream of tiny particles called quanta. The implications that would eventually arise from this theory, a cosmos without strict causality or certainty, would spook him for the rest of his life. The second paper is a determination of the true sizes of atoms. Even though the very existence of atoms was still in dispute, this was the most straightforward of the papers, which is why he chose it as the safest bet for his latest attempt at a doctoral thesis. He was in the process of revolutionizing physics, but he had been repeatedly thwarted in his efforts to win an academic job or even get a doctoral degree, which he hoped might get him promoted from a third to a second-class examiner at the patent office. The third paper explained the jittery motion of microscopic particles in liquid by using a statistical analysis of random collisions. In the process, it established that atoms and molecules actually exist. The fourth paper is only a rough draft at this point and is an electrodynamics of moving bodies which employs a modification of the theory of space and time. Well, that was certainly more than inconsequential babble. Based purely on thought experiments, performed in his head rather than in a lab, he had decided to discard Newton's concepts of absolute space and time. It would become known as the special theory of relativity. What he did not tell his friend, because it had not yet occurred to him, was that he would produce a fifth paper that year, a short addendum to the fourth, which posited a relationship between energy and mass. Out of it would arise the best known equation in all of physics, E equals mc squared. Looking back at a century that will be remembered for its willingness to break classical bonds, and looking ahead to an era that seeks to nurture the creativity needed for scientific innovation, one person stands out as a paramount icon of our age. The kindly refugee from oppression, whose wild halo of hair, twinkling eyes, engaging humanity, and extraordinary brilliance made his face a symbol and his name a synonym for genius. Albert Einstein was a locksmith, blessed with imagination and guided by a faith in the harmony of nature's handiwork. His fascinating story, a testament to the connection between creativity and freedom, reflects the triumphs and tumults of the modern era. Einstein's life and work reflected the disruption of societal certainties and moral absolutes in the modernist atmosphere of the early 20th century. Imaginative nonconformity was in the air. Picasso, Joyce, Freud, Stravinsky, Schoenberg, and others were breaking conventional bonds. Charging this atmosphere was a conception of the universe in which space and time and the properties of particles seemed based on the vagaries of observations. Einstein, however, was not truly a relativist, even though that is how he was interpreted by many, including some whose disdain was tinged by anti-Semitism. Beneath all of his theories, including relativity, was a quest for invariance, certainties, and absolutes. There was a harmonious reality underlying the laws of the universe, Einstein felt, and the goal of science was to discover it.
an explanation, an insight, a much deeper insight into what's going on than ever before. And I often use the expression, a joy of insight. And this is one of the most beautiful feelings as a scientist. And it happens perhaps once a year, when you find something new, or when you hear something new, and get the idea, understood something. You have this joy of now seeing deeper into the riddles. And without that joy, the life of a scientist would be very dull. Now, these ideas of quantum mechanics were so inspiring, so deep, and so, I would say, wonderful, that I believe it helped me a great deal, and must have had others too, or my colleagues, to survive, to be mentally sane during this terrible time of Nazism and persecution in the 30s. We always had the idea that here is something great. And I often say to my students when they speak about the bad times, there were two things that kept me alive and human. And this is, I usually say, it is Mozart and it is quantum mechanics. He do the sheet, that enemy of the world, Hitler. And therefore we were not much thinking about the deep moralities of it. But to be frank, I'm sure there were other reasons too. After all, I was a pretty young fellow at that time. I was not one of the leaders of physics. And all the great people went into this, and of course there was a strong urge to be with them and to participate in this great experience that you can release the cosmic forces that were hidden in the nucleus. It has never been shown before, except in the center of the sun.
May 1945.
I have had a little guilt to leave the others alone when I would have run away at that time.
In June 1945, the first atomic bomb was ready. But the test had an unexpected side. The first atomic bomb was ready. But the test had an unexpected side.
The test of the first nuclear bomb and the Alamogordo test, it had to be postponed by about 4 hours. There was an intercom system, and that intercom system was the same wavelength as a local radio station. And this is one of the most grotesque and uncanny feelings I had when the countdown started. 10, 9, 8... You heard the background music, the Nutcracker Suite by Tchaikovsky. Da 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 da. Whenever I hear that melody, the whole thing comes back to me. And then zero, and here was the explosion. Life of the nation, of the world. secondly, of course, it raised the reputation of science. It was then very easy to get good jobs and support for research, which are all things that are perhaps not of primary importance, but they are of importance. And third, it showed to all of us that the problems of life are not simple. Oppenheimer expressed it in this characteristic way: we scientists have learned sin. I think that's a somewhat problematic way of expressing it, but it gives the ambiance. It says what I meant to say, that we saw that things, all things are connected, the good and the bad. That science is not only for the good, it can also be for the bad.
Victor Weisskopf had started to have second thoughts about the role of science in society. He began to feel that scientists had a responsibility to communicate with the public, to warn when science might be harmful, and to work for solutions to such problems. After the war, Weisskopf renounced atomic bomb work. He joined other scientists in an effort to achieve international control of nuclear weapons. But there was little public or political response at that time, and these concerns got nowhere. But it did set Weisskopf on a path which he would always follow. Meanwhile, the Cold War was developing, and the government and military had now learned the value of science applied to war. They poured money into research. Soon, one out of every two scientists was supported by military grants. Even Weisskopf did some military work, albeit non-nuclear.
World War II has shown that those egg-headed physicists can be quite useful. So let's support them so that in case of another war, we have them ready again. I think that's what's essential to the philosophy. There were very few strings attached to that money. So there were some of us, and I include myself, who were a little leery. We didn't like this idea that our great science now is almost exclusively supported by money coming from the armed forces. But it was a fact.
Weisskopf had now gone to the Massachusetts Institute of Technology to teach and to write a textbook on theoretical nuclear physics. This book became the Bible for university students for two decades to come. Meanwhile, on the experimental side of physics, scientists were building bigger and bigger machines. Machines for particle research, to probe into the nucleus, the very center of the atom. These cyclotrons, or accelerators, shoot beams of electrons and nuclear particles at great speed or energy to collide with other minute particles.
It is one of the paradoxes of quantum mechanics that the smaller the object is, the higher energy do you need to get into it. That means also that the larger instruments you need. And so the cyclotrons began to grow. Before the war, every university could have a cyclotron. After the war, the new instruments, synchrotrons, accelerators became so big that the university can no longer afford it, and it must be on a national scale. And then something came about which is called big physics. It means it is no longer the one man with a few assistants who does the experiment, but a whole team of 10 or 12 people supported by another 20 or 50 mechanics and engineers.
One big physics institution was the European International.
Life with its painful harshness. and legendariness. One now who is more finely tempered is driven to escape from personal existence to the world of objective observing and understanding. This motive can be compared with the longing that irresistibly pulls the city dweller away from his noisy, cramped quarters towards the silent, high mountains. Man tries to make himself, in the fashion that suits him best, a simplified and intelligible picture of the world. He then tries, to some extent, to substitute this cosmos of his for the world of experience, and thus to transcend it. This is what the painter, the poet, the philosopher, and the natural scientist do, each in his own way. Albert Einstein's discoveries in physics ranged from the molecular to the universe. His formative years, the years of his unequal creativity, were spent here in Switzerland. In his education and his character may be revealed answers to the riddle of all genius.
After the success of his dark nuclear comedy, Dr. Strangelove, Stanley Kubrick began a major motion picture. It was to be a film about abstract scientific ideas, the origin and the future of the human species, life in the cosmos, the evolution of our machines and artificial intelligence. Even to this day, Kubrick's 2001 A Space Odyssey remains the all-time great science fiction film. Its groundbreaking photographic techniques still influence modern special effects. But as our films get ever more spectacular, 2001 reminds us that it's the ideas behind the spectacle that are still the most important special effect of all.
As far as I'm concerned, predicted the future, not simply of space travel, but of the nature of the human soul.
It's puzzling. I don't think I've ever seen anything quite like this before.
Thank you.
behind us.
I can feel pretty much others on Wall Street. How many? 200, 300, maybe 400 at most? For these men, for these masters of the universe? And Sherman McCoy was one of them. There were no limits whatsoever. Let's go! I'm down, bro. Yes, sure.
Mom?
Sorry,
old lady.
Jesus Christ, surely you must be made of ice. Just remember, you're only a frantic salesman. Is it dead?
But what the hell is this crazy geese car deal gonna cost us, Sherman?
Well, I need $600 million to buy up the bonds.
Jesus, you want us to sit on $600 million worth of French government bonds?
Oh, I'm confident on this, Gene. It's a real sleeping beauty.
Where are you, Gene?
I'm in a cricket match. Somebody just hit the hell out of the ball. But the ball's kind of dead, though.
Who's playing?
Don't get technical on me, Rolly. Watch out, nice young man in white flannel pants.
Gene, how about it? Are we in or out?
Gold has to hold steady, and if the rank starts to drop...
Bernard Sachs is already in for $300 million. Does that make you feel any better?
Sherman, you are going to make me...
The rich old man, Gene. The rich old man.
A $600 million deal. Sherman's commission would be $1.7 million.
I'm looking at
all the days. It was there. At the top. Impervious. Untouchable. Insulated by wealth and power. A master of the universe. Great hunter.
Greetings in 60 human languages and the salutations of the humpback whales. The record cover bears instructions on how to hear the sounds and see the pictures encoded on the disc, including some snapshots from the family album of a distant world. The Voyager record is a message in a bottle cast into the cosmic ocean. The recipients, if any, will understand that we were a species endowed with hope and perseverance. No one sends such a message on such a journey without a positive passion for the future and a longing to make contact with the cosmos.
The best of cosmos now leaves our solar neighborhood for the open seas of interstellar space, where the scales of distance and time are beyond human experience. And understanding requires an increasingly counterintuitive approach. The subject of atomic structure and gravity can pose a daunting challenge to the most gifted communicator. However, for me, this is one of the places where Cosmos best captures the emotional and spiritual uplift of the sweep of cosmic evolution. Cosmos was filmed in 40 locations around the planet. It was a two-year journey that deepened our appreciation for the diverse beauty of Earth. Surely one of the loveliest locations was Tuscany, where we went to retrace the young Albert Einstein's insights into relativity as he roamed the Italian countryside. Whenever I watch this particular sequence, I recall a break in filming when Carl and I savored a simple tablecloth picnic in the Oz-like poppy fields there. It's one of my favorite memories of the great adventure of the making of Cosmos.
The year here is 2000.
Stars are born.
The Einsteinian hierarchical approach to the pure gravitational unified field structure of the atomistic hierarchy does not exist and never did exist.
Only 1,500 light years from Earth, parts of which are collapsing under gravity.